life and how he ended and the outcome of his childhood decisions. There was a lot here to learn. We'd like to open our Bibles for the key text on Psalms 105, verses 17 to 24. He said,
spicy food.
Even Joseph, who was sold for a servant, whose feet they hurt with fetters, he was laid in iron. Until the time that his word come, the word of the Lord tried him. The king sent and loosed him, even the ruler of the people, and let him go free. He made him lord of his house and ruler of his substance, to bind his princes at his pleasure and teach him wisdom. Israel also came into Egypt, and Jacob sojourned in the land, and he increased his people greatly and made them stronger than their enemies. So even David sang the praises of Joseph. The first 17 years of Joseph's life was spent in his father's household. And as we continue on, we'll realize the significance of this part of his life. What were the principal points recorded in the early life of Joseph? And I summarized them in a few points, with the love of Jacob for him, his coat of many colors, Joseph's dream, and being sold as a slave. Coat of many colors had something I hadn't come across before. The old father knew that Reuben had forfeited his right to officiate as priest of the household. As the patriarch watched the godly life of Joseph, it would be only natural that he would select him as the one worthy to fill the holy office. It is possible that in vision he may have been permitted to see the great heavenly priest, and that he had made the coat as a faint representation of the priestly robe to be worn by his descendants. So I thought it was just showing favor to him, but it was also brings in that he may have seen some significance in this special coat that he made Joseph. And a very important point I want to go into now is his childhood and what made Joseph who he really was. You know, in Psalms 105, 17 to 24 that we just read, what stayed with Joseph when in the most trying circumstances? In Crossing the Shadow 341, the psalmist says in Psalms 105, 17 to 24, the word of the Lord tried him. He believed the word of God that had been taught him in childhood. It was that word that kept him courageous in prison and humble when ruling Egypt. His strength, both in adversity and in prosperity, came from the mighty God of Jacob. So what did he remember when he was going through trying circumstances?
The word that he was taught.
That's right. He believed the word of God that had been taught to him when?
In childhood.
And I believe Brother Aaron has brought out how important it is to us to learn and to remember what we've been taught in childhood. Brother Chuck the other night too had a good experience, and we can always look back. Who of us can remember who had godly parents, are grateful that we had godly parents, and what we have learned by them? And I think we can all be grateful that we have, when we have Christian parents, that we have the opportunity to have basically an advantage to have, to be able to look back and be stronger because of our childhood training. And it brought out very strongly the significance of Joseph's mother in his life. Crossing the Shadow, page 342. When considering the strict integrity of Joseph in the midst of Egyptian darkness, we must not forget that Rachel, his mother, lived until he was about 16 years of age. After she had, by her godly instruction, fortified her son for the great life work before him, God in mercy laid Rachel to rest before Joseph was sold into Egypt, so she was spared that great sorrow. And throughout eternity she will see the fruit of her training, for it was no doubt his mother's godly instruction that enabled Joseph to connect so closely with God, that his bow abode in strength and the arms of his hand were made strong by the hands of the mighty God of Jacob. So by her godly instruction, she fortified Joseph for his great life work. And that's a lot of significance, especially to me as a mother. In Proverbs 1, verse 8, says, "My son, hear the instruction of thy father, and forsake not the law of thy mother." In Crossing the Shadow, page 342, it quotes, "Happy the mother that gives, and thrice happy the child that receives such instruction. There is a power in godly training in childhood that molds the character. It places a diadem of grace on the head of one who receives it." So Joseph had a significant asset until he was 16 years of age. He had a godly mother. Also, his father had quite a lot of influence in Joseph's life. But his father, Rachel, was the wife that he loved. Joseph was firstborn, and we see the tendency of what his father gave to Joseph. His father, this is found in Patriarchs and Prophets, page 213, his father, strong and tender as his love had been, had done him wrong by his partiality and indulgence. This unwise preference had angered his brothers and provoked them to the cruel deed that had separated him from his home. Its effects were manifested also in his own character. Faults had been encouraged that were now to be corrected. He was becoming self-sufficient and exacting. Accustomed to the tenderness of his father's care, he felt that he was unprepared to cope with the difficulties before him in the bitter, uncared-for life of a stranger and a slave. So, I'm not going through the story of Joseph, I'm bringing out highlights here. But Joseph was 16 years of age. 17 years of age, he was taken as a slave. So he was a young man. And he had to realize where he stood and where his future would go. And also, a lot of us here around our late 20s or 30s, there's quite a few of us here. And it says here, "How old was Joseph before he stood before Pharaoh and was then honored second place in the kingdom?" In Genesis 41:46, it says, "And Joseph was 30 years old when he stood before Pharaoh, the king of Egypt." A lot of things happened in his life until he was 30 years old, and he was able to stand second place before Pharaoh. And that's a very high responsibility. So Joseph had learned a lot of things in his childhood that had prepared him to be a great leader at 30 years of age. Also, what was the difference between the blessings of Joseph and the blessings of the other sons?
Pardon?
Yes. In Crossing Its Shadow, that's true. It's one thing that I was bringing out about his childhood. The dying patriarch, this is found in Crossing Its Shadow, page 342. The dying patriarch, as he thought of the character of Joseph, remembered the years of faithful instruction with Rachel, which had given him from his birth until death separated them. The mothers of the other sons are not mentioned in the blessings. I thought that was interesting. His mother was mentioned as he was being blessed. So she played, and Jacob realized this as he blessed Joseph, that she played a significant part in Joseph's godly training. The character of Joseph. This is very important because this is where the descendants carry. Did Joseph have resentment toward his brothers for selling him as a slave? And who did he hold responsible? And how can we learn from this? Genesis 45 verse 8. So now it was not you that sent me hither, but God, and he hath made me a father to Pharaoh, and lord of all his house, and a ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. In Genesis 50, verse 20. But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring to pass, as it is this day, to save much people alive. Joseph, who did he hold responsible for changing his life?
His brothers.
Did he hold his brothers responsible?
No.
God.
Who did he hold?
God.
Isn't that something we have to learn? That sometimes our life, we may think we have, someone's done us a terrible wrong, and if we look back, if we become closer to God, he realized he could see God's hand in this. And crossing that shadow, 341, Joseph had no resentment in his heart. He could say to those men, so now it was not you that sent me hither, but God, and he hath made me a father to Pharaoh, and lord of all his house, and a ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good to bring to pass that he lived this day, to save much people alive. Joseph saw only the Lord's hand in it all. In Prophets and Patriarchs and Prophets 2:31. When Joseph revealed himself to his brothers, and this was quite a scary time for the brothers to realize that this was Joseph standing as a ruler in front of them, and he could have easily put them to death. When Joseph revealed himself to his brothers, he spoke to them kindly, saying, I am Joseph, your brother, whom ye sold into Egypt. Now therefore be not grieved nor angry with yourselves that ye sold me hither, for God did send me before you to preserve life. Feeling that they had already suffered enough for their cruelty toward him, he nobly sought to banish their fears and lessen the bitterness of their self-reproach. And I thought that was a wonderful character attribute that he had. Who did he hold responsible for his experience, even though they seem hard at this time? I'm going to continue on. Patriarchs and Prophets 2:31, and God sent me before you to preserve you posterity in the earth and save your lives by a great deliverance. So now it was not you that sent me hither, but all his house, and a ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. He could see from beginning to end, Joseph realized that God did this to be able to save his people. He foresaw that in sending Joseph to Egypt was to preserve all of his brethren. Also in Patriarchs and Prophets 2:39, when Jacob died, Joseph's brothers were again afraid. They dared not appear before him in person, but sent a message. Thy father did command before he died, saying, so shall he say unto Joseph, forgive, I pray thee, now the trespass of thy brethren and their sin, for they did eat unto thee evil, and now we pray thee, forgive the trespass of the servants and of the God of thy father. They were already acknowledging themselves as servants of Joseph. They were fulfilling Joseph's dream. This message affected Joseph to tears, and encouraged by this, His brothers came and fell down before him with the words, "Behold, we be thy servants." Joseph's love for his brothers was deep and unselfish, and he was pained at the thought that they could regard him as cherishing a spirit of revenge toward them. "Fear not," he said, "for am I in the place of God? But as for you, ye thought evil against me. But God meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day, to save much people alive. Now therefore fear you not, I will nourish you and your little ones." Isn't that something? If you have wronged someone and someone could say that to you, how would that make you respond? Wouldn't that make you love God? It's amazing, you know, can you really tell someone, well, you know, really, thank you for doing that terrible thing to me, but I think God saw that I needed that, and God's made something good out of this. And if we could just do this, to see that God is in everything in our lives, whether good or not. Joseph was able to see God's providence in all circumstances. Now, if we go back a little bit, he was being taken away, and he just remembered the last remembrance was the cruelty of his brothers. And they sold him as a slave. That was the worst thing that he could probably think of, away from his father. And as we read before, that he was being petted, he was quite a favored child. And he was there gone to Egypt. And how long did it take to change? Does it take to change your life around for the Lord? And how long did Joseph take to make that decision? Genesis 39:1-3.
And Joseph was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him of the hands of the Ishmaelites, which had brought him down thither. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. And Psalms 18:35. Thou hast also given me the shield of thy salvation, and thy right hand hath holden me up, and thy gentleness hath made me great. How long does it take to change a life around? Cross in its Shadow, page 214. One day's experience had been the turning point in Joseph's life. Its terrible calamity had transformed him from a petted child to a man, thoughtful, courageous, and self-possessed. So it only took one day, that decision, as he traveled, to make a decision to turn himself into a man that saved the nation. What firm decision did Joseph make after his brothers sold him into slavery? Genesis 39:1-3, which I read, those two texts. Patriarchs and Prophets 2:1-3-2:1-4. Joseph believed that the God of his father would be his God. He then and there gave himself fully to the Lord, and he prayed that the keeper of Israel would be with him in the land of exile. His soul thrilled with the high resolve to prove himself true to God under all circumstances, to act as become a subject of the King of Heaven. He would serve the Lord with undivided heart. He would meet the trials of his lot with fortitude and perform every duty with fidelity. And page 213 on Patriarchs and Prophets, Joseph had learned in a few hours that which years might not otherwise have taught him. First Selected Messages 3:27. We ask to surrender our hearts to God, that he may renew and sanctify us and fit us for his heavenly court. We are not to wait for a special time, but today we are to give ourselves to him, refusing to be the servants of sin. Do you imagine you can leave off sin a little at a time? Oh, leave the accursed thing at once. Hate the things that Christ hates and love the things that Christ loves. Joseph made a decision and he carried it through for the rest of his life. And if we can make those decisions early in our life, it will help us to be firm for the rest of our life. And he stuck by those decisions. How have many cost their positions because of their convictions? Now, if we read earlier that Joseph became an officer and he worked for a man called Potiphar, and he was being tested, and this test tested him to the uttermost. When the wife of his master tried to entrap him, his reply was, "How can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" This showed his strict integrity, but it cost him his position. From the place of honor, he was cast into prison. God vindicated Joseph, and he was honored by being placed in charge of all the prisoners. He accepted his position in the prison as from the hand of the Lord. So what did he lose when he showed his strict integrity? Was that important to lose his position? But if we read in the Bible, it says that his master saw that the Lord was with him. He knew Joseph. And if he knew Joseph enough, we believe that he did not believe Joseph was guilty of that crime. Because if he believed Joseph was guilty of that crime, what would have happened to Joseph? He would have been killed. So he was put in prison. And what did Joseph do in that prison? I mean, look, now's the end of me. I've lost my position. Did he continue living a godly life in prison? That's right. Did he blame God? No, he was in no time, he was in charge of the prison. When living a righteous life, who notices? Genesis 39:3, as I brought out before, and his master saw that the Lord was with him. What was that great text that if we could say to ourselves, and our young people especially can learn, in Genesis 39:9, many of us often quote, "Get thee behind me, Satan." But this is another very important text as we go through life, Genesis 39:9. The last bit, it says, "And then how can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" If we could remember that when we're being tempted. What other character of the Bible was Joseph compared to? Can we remember? This was interesting to me as I read this. Crossing at Shadow, page 343. Joseph saw that the hand of God in all the events of his life. Job manifested the same spirit when he said, "The Lord gave and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." This spirit cherished in the heart today will make a great man, the same as in the days of Job and Joseph. So Job was likened unto Joseph. And especially, what other character did Joseph's life illustrate? Christ. Isn't that wonderful to have a record that your character was like Christ? In Patriarchs and Prophets 2:39, the life of Joseph illustrates the life of Christ. It was envy that moved the brothers of Joseph to sell him as a slave. They hoped to prevent him from becoming greater than themselves. So the Jewish priests and elders were jealous of Christ, fearing that he would attract the attention of the people from them. They put him to death to prevent him from being king, but they were thus bringing about the very result. Joseph, through his bondage in Egypt, became a savior to his father's family. So the crucifixion of Christ by his enemies made him the redeemer of mankind, the Savior of the fallen race and ruler of the whole world. Did Joseph ever prove untrue to God? It says, a cross and its shadow, 344. During Joseph's long life of 110 years, we have no record of his ever proving untrue to God in any way. Also, cross and its shadow, 339. In the pages of sacred history, Joseph stands prominent among the few characters of whom inspiration has recorded no faults. What was Joseph's final reward? I want to summarize that he received double portion of inheritance, and also in Revelation 7, 5 to 8, Manasseh was one of his sons is mentioned, and also of the tribe of Joseph were sealed 12,000. In summary, Joseph's main traits of character: he always saw the Lord's providence in situations, whether pleasant or not. He held no resentment. He showed forgiveness. He stuck by his decisions to God and his fellow men. He remembered and upheld his parents' childhood training. He was true to God even under strong temptations. He showed patience and meekness under injustice and oppression. And I'd like to finish off with a quote on education, page 57. The history of Joseph is an illustration of what God will do for those who yield themselves to him and with the whole heart seek to accomplish his purpose. The greatest want of the world is the want of men who will not be bought or sold, men who are in their inmost souls are true and honest, men who will not fear to call sin by its right name, men whose conscience is as true to duty as a needle to the pole, men who will stand for the right though the heavens fall. But such a character is not a result of accident. It is not due to special favors or endowments of providence. A noble character is a result of self-discipline, of the subjection of the lower to the higher nature, the surrender of self for the service of love to God and man. And sometimes we think, well, I'm only one person, do I have much influence? But Joseph was only one man, and he had a lot of influence throughout generations. And it's wonderful if we could be a Joseph and illustrate the life of Christ in our lives as Joseph did.